Welcome to the podcast that explores the heartlands entertainment industries. I'm Brian.
I'm Kelly.
And we're here, and it's the new year.
It's the new year.
I know that, like, we've been putting out episodes, you know, for a while now in 2019, but for us, recording-wise, this is our first episode of 2019. Yeah. It's that weird future past thing that we're always hovering around in. So how you been? How are the holidays?
They were a thing.
They were there.
Now, we didn't travel nearly as much, which was awesome, but we did go up north.
To the north?
Yeah, we went to Nebraska, and you went to Iowa. You know. Oh, yeah.
Oh, sure.
We went up there, and it snowed, and my kids got to play in the snow.
That's good. See, there was nothing up there. It was just cold. Oh. That's the most disappointing thing in the world, when you trek 8 hours to the north.
There should be snow.
Yeah.
That's how it was when we first arrived, and I was upset.
Yeah.
Like, what is the point of it being 12 degrees outside, and there's no snow?
And the Lord heard you and said,
bunch of corn.
Bless you.
Yeah. So the kids made it out for like 5 minutes. That was about as long as they made it outside.
They were super appreciative.
They're super oaky.
Yeah.
Well, that's the
funny thing is, like, I have come to realize that I am not impervious to cold. It's the cold for Okies compared to cold for northerners is night and day.
Yeah.
Dear God. Like, I was working with some New Yorkers the other day, and it was like 60 degrees outside. Jesus, it's freaking cold. And they're like, it's warm.
Yeah, this is really nice weather. You're like, I need to take
my jacket off. It's freaking hot.
It's so hot outside. Yeah. Let's go to a club.
You people are insane. So, yeah.
What about you? You survived the holidays?
We survived. I was so ready for the holidays to be over. Like, dude, Thanksgiving, Christmas, and New Year's are too close together.
Yeah.
It's just too much celebration.
Yeah.
It's not too much family and all that kind of stuff. It's just too much stuff going on.
Sometimes it can be too much family for me. But I love my family.
My family all gets along. I don't understand. Like, my brain doesn't compute families that, like, have those Thanksgiving dinners or Christmas dinners and everyone hates each other.
Yeah.
I'm like, what did you do wrong?
Well, my family just drinks a lot, so that usually ends in something crazy.
My family drinks a lot in secret.
Yeah. Private drinking. We also do that. I do hide a bottle of wine in my room just in case.
There's a lot of sneaking schnapps and whiskey and all that stuff. My grandmother does not approve at all. And my grandpa he's like the eye in the storm that's just like, well, same shit
just
as always.
Just planted and there and taking it all in. And you just sit down and get their thoughts, but they're never going to share.
Yep.
Mm-mm.
Yep. But, you know, the good part of a lot of alcohol consumption, everyone's happy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everyone is chemically induced joyful. It's the best. So today we are talking to Mr. Perrin and Mrs. Shannon Smith. Welcome to the Okie Show. It's about darn time.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And you guys are with the talent agency BK Talent. And first of all, thanks for sponsoring some shows. And you guys are also patrons on Patreon.
Woo! You got to pay to play. Woo! I'm just teasing. In this industry, that's a bad thing.
Yeah. So we're going to be talking today about just the kind of in and outs of a talent agency, kind of the difference between like an agency and an agent and that kind of thing. But first of all, just tell us about yourselves. Like, how did you get into this biz?
Well, let's see. I'll talk about myself and then I'll let Shannon talk about herself because, well, the invitation said Perrin and Shannon. So I'm going to start it off that way. I am the agent and owner of BK Talent Agency. How I became the owner of this great enterprise, which you are currently signed with, just as to be upfront with.
This is totally self-serving.
This is definitely this sponsored.
Shannon is also signed with the company. Both of them signed before I became the owner, for the record.
So
did my
can
daughter.
I sign too?
Sure.
I need to get in on
Kelly's
this.
Next.
We're not going to predate this.
So. Yeah.
Maybe pre-error date, but not, no. Anyway. Yeah. So as a kid, I grew up doing stage and doing band and performing, never got any money for it. My wife, this really pretty story, go back with her. I'll tell it and she'll correct me. We were at Boise State. Sorry, all you OU fans. 2007 was a great game.
I agree, because I'm an later. OSU fan.
We just lost half the audience.
That's right. OSU beat us.
Oh, you did beat us this year, but they have to travel to our house in a couple of years. So good luck on the blue.
Right.
So I'm at Boise State working, and my wife is a student back in the 90s at Boise State, and she's a theater major. And I'm about to go do some service for a church and spend 2 years doing something else and fall madly in love with this pretty girl. And then I come back from church service and marry this pretty girl and whisk her to parts unknown 20 years throughout the world, and working on aircraft and getting shelled and earning myself 100% disability through the VA and finally retire. Yes, I've lived my dream.
There you go.
20 years.
There you go.
And she's in the background going, I still want to act. I still want to act. I'm not feeling fulfilled here. So I get to tinker, start my retirement process, and she's like, that's it. I'm done. I'm starting to act. And so she did a couple of shows with local community theater, and it's like, this still isn't what I want. And so she did Meals for Monologue down for Chris Fryhofer at the Actor Factory. And at which point I will let Shannon fill that in, but it basically gave her a huge compliment on who are you and where you, why have I never seen you before?
Yeah.
And eventually she signed with Switzer Talent Agent, and then Switzer shifted gears with Becky Switzer's passion shifting away from helping actors to another aspect. And then she established Ground Zero. Ground Zero
K-9
or something like that.
Oh, cool. I've always wondered what happened to Becky with all that.
She went with the passion. One of her son's friends died in the Moore tornado in 2013. Okay. And so she's training dogs now and has...
Search
and rescue
dogs.
Oh,
wow. Okay.
And has upwards of 40 dogs in a F5-proof shelter. At any time, that's where they sleep, is an F5 shelter. So that if...
That's legit.
Oklahoma gets hit,
they're
ready to go search and rescue.
Oh, wow.
At a moment's notice.
That's really cool.
And that will increase survivability.
Well, and the dogs don't go just to Oklahoma.
Right. And they'll go to they go all over.
And anywhere they're needed, because she's like, if there's more dogs locally, then they can get to situations
as they
faster.
Get trained,
and more people can survive.
We keep a few of them local so they can go, but she's getting more dogs into the system for search and rescue, and they're trained and they're certified, and they have
everything
they need.
Are they training basset hounds?
You'll have to ask Becky. My name's not Becky. I don't have that paycheck associated
with
my
name. You can step in and take over that front, Brian.
In case
the basset hound F5 tornado training group.
Well, I'm thinking,
I'm
thinking in the event that my body disappears from the face of the earth, you know, if the colonel can be trained to find me.
To find you?
Yeah. That would be ideal.
Probably only when he's hungry. Yeah, I think he would eat you. Only if you have food in your pocket.
He's been just biding his time. Yeah.
So Becky Switzer said, I want to do that with my free time now.
Yeah.
And so she let everybody know, hey, as of this day, I'm closing my doors. And another.
So you always get this part wrong.
Okay. Shannon will step up.
So how BK started is Billy Krause, her son's an actor. And she found that she was doing more for him and finding him jobs than his agent that they were had in Tulsa.
Oh, okay.
Which that agency is closed. So it's not even like we're not talking about Linda Lynn.
Right.
It's, you know,
it's an agency that exists no more.
Yes.
Correct. Right. And so she started BK as a way to help her son and, you know, as this other agency was closing, she bought their client list.
Yeah.
Not Switzer's.
not Switzer's.
The one that's now defunct.
But then as Becky was closing her doors, she did her research at other agents, at all the agencies around, and let them know, okay, I'm closing my doors, so my roster is going to start.
Yeah. These people are up for grabs. You. They need representation.
And then she let the actors know these are the agencies in the area.
Yeah.
And she listed BK as one of them, which is why there's quite a few Switzer people that are at BK.
I've noticed that because it seems like there was like a migration to BK.
And it wasn't a planned thing like, hey, all you Switzer people go to BK. It was, that's just where they seemed to end up.
And for clarification, there are Switzer people with the other two reputable agents in the state, which is Linda Lehman and Magna Talent.
Right.
I'm not here to be upfront. I'm not here to do anything but be positive for the three of us.
Yeah.
For once in the entire state history that I'm aware of, all the agencies talk to each other, get along with each other.
That's fantastic.
And actually give each other hugs in front of people.
Yeah, that's great. That's how it should be, man. We're too small to be competing so hardcore with each other.
There's unity.
Plenty of work.
Yes. Yeah.
So
they're coworkers.
That's great to hear.
I mean, we all work in the industry.
So I will speak positively, even behind closed doors, even one-on-one, about the other two reputable agencies in the state. If there are people that say, hey, I'm an agency too, congratulations, I don't know about you.
It doesn't mean you don't
like
exist.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean you're not trying to do great stuff. We just
are the three major agencies that are putting people in front of SAG, in front of
the casting directors.
Casting directors, both locally, nationally. One of my talent has gone and performed on BBC.
There you go.
Not my doing, but it did happen. So congratulations, Brian.
So you can say internationally as well.
Yeah. Bing. Boom. Yeah.
But we do. Anyway, so Billy was a CPA or still is a CPA.
Still
and her
is.
Passion is numbers. She looks at a spreadsheet and gets all giggly. I don't understand those kind of people.
I know. She's,
my husband her is a CPA.
Yeah.
I don't understand them either, and I love him.
So the tax law changed last year, and Billy's like, I was working 10 hours a week, and now I'm working 60 plus. Wow. I can't do both.
So the same thing that happened to Becky happened to Billy. She's like, I can't do the talent agency and my passion. Yeah. So
here you go, world.
So Shannon at that time had been working head office for Billy. And so it was very easy for me to take over ownership and everything else because I already had a trained employee.
And at least I got along with my new boss. I was a little worried.
So if there's any other jokes in there, we'll tell them later.
Yeah.
But HR's not complaining. She's getting the benefits.
I am HR.
What's going on in this office?
So, but we work from a virtual office cell phones and desktops, laptops, and
2019, man, it's kind of cool.
So, but we do have, I try to focus most of our talent being Oklahoma based. I do have people that have gone on to other markets that we still represent here. Kate Jones,
we had her
on Atlanta.
Has she officially moved to Atlanta now?
Yes.
And
she's coming back for a project, though.
Expatriate.
she actually flies in
Monday.
She will have flown in when you hear this and flown
and
back to Atlanta.
Yeah, she'll be back in Atlanta.
Unless
kidnaps her and
air at a future time.
Unless we
bunker and keep you may not leave Kay Jones. We like you too much.
But so we do have people that leave the Oklahoma market, the Dallas market, and come back for projects. I'm just citing Kate Jones because that one's specific to
the most recent
relevant right now.
Yeah. Well, she's a name that a lot of people are in here.
Yeah.
And she's awesome.
And she's
pretty
awesome.
She's great.
Yeah. She's okay.
I saw her in that Jurassic Games movie. She's all right.
Just because she died. Anyways.
So I'm curious, I'm sure that for the layman listener that's tuned in, you know, when they hear about like an agency or a talent agent or something like that, those lines can get crossed. Kind of like whenever we were talking to Chris Freihoffer, a lot of people don't understand what exactly a casting director is versus, as opposed to an agent or a manager or something like that. There's a lot of different titles that do a lot of different things.
So
the easiest way to describe this, I will let the actor, which is my wife, and my office manager explain the actor's view on it, and then I'll talk about the agent and the manager, and then I'll let Shannon talk about the casting director and the director.
There you go.
Is that fair?
That's fair.
Okay. Yeah. So you talked about the actor and your side.
So there's this perception that an agent can't be an actor, and it's because of a perception of conflict of interest. Mm-hmm. And SAG actually has rules against actors being agents because they don't want an agent to put themselves
ahead they don't want to,
of their actors, because then that's not fair to the actors they represent. Mm-hmm. So I want to make it clear, and I've always tried to make it clear, I'm not the agent. I'm not the one who makes decisions about who is represented. I don't make decisions on who gets submitted for projects.
Right.
Because of how BK sends out casting calls, really the actor is the one who decides whether or not they want to be submitted.
Yeah.
And that's unique to Oklahoma. That's not how other agencies are run. Most of the time you get submitted for stuff and you never know.
You don't even really,
you only know when you get auditions.
Yeah.
So and that's as close as Dallas. The Dallas agents, if you have a Dallas agent, you never hear from them until
you get the audition.
Yeah.
Ooh. And if you can't make that audition time, that's not their fault.
You failed to let them know your schedule.
Right.
And
I was going to say that can be problematic really fast.
Yeah. So we are such a small market and so many actors have other jobs that this is the way Switzer did it. It's the way Billy did it. Magna and Linda Lehman also do it similar to this, where we first ask the actors for if they're available and interested. So
which I can say for somebody like myself with a crazy schedule.
Yes.
That's appreciated.
Yeah.
Well, and also sometimes you get casting calls that it's a role that you're not necessarily comfortable with.
It's like you fit, and but you're like...
Yeah, and I would feel conflicted about being submitted for like a nude scene or something like that.
Right, but something you'd have to turn down once you find out that was not
thanks,
what I wanted.
Thanks, but... Not nude. Looking at my butt today.
So
you're lucky.
Yeah. I'm not.
You're welcome.
So I'm not actually deciding who gets submitted, which is something an agent would do. Which, as an actor, you're like, I don't want them not submitting me because I conflict with them.
Yeah.
Which I have been accused of that, and it's not. That's never happened.
I have been accused of things.
Because you guys are kind of the gatekeepers, and I feel like the gatekeepers
I'm not a gatekeeper. Don't put that burden on me.
Right.
The gatekeeper is the talent in this state.
Mm.
My wife and I were talking about this on the way home, or on the way over here. Because we allow you to pick what projects you work, that makes you the gatekeeper.
Mm.
And you pick the projects you want. I show you, the agent's job is to show you where the audition door is.
Right.
It is the talent's job
to go
through the door and
book
nail it or self-eliminate.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, and a casting director, their job is, they facilitate the audition process. No, you said I was going to talk about the casting directors. You talk about the agents.
So
they facilitate the process of the auditions. Now, they've had several conversations with production about their vision, about the script, about the feel that they're looking for, the kind of actor that they're looking for. So we may look at it and I may see, they want a Caucasian female 35 to 50 and 6 foot tall. And I may think, this is perfect for me. But there may be conversations that the casting director has had with production that I'm not the right actor for it. So the casting director's not going to call me in because they know I'm not what production's looking for.
Right.
Whereas
that's because Shannon looks like the director's ex-wife.
Or
it's always some trivial reason.
Reason
I am not a small person. Growing up, we called it big boned.
Let me know what 6 foot person is small.
I am of German descent, and so I'm a larger person. And that may not be what they're looking for.
Casting director might have a specific time.
They want someone more athletic looking, or they want someone that's like super, super, super skinny, thin, or they don't want a redhead.
But the agent doesn't have that information, whereas the casting director would.
Through conversations, and also casting directors, when they see the actors over and over, they kind of get a feel of how that actor acts.
And their capabilities.
And their capabilities and their strengths. And maybe it's a very, very slapstick comedy, which I wouldn't be good at. I'm good at more of the sarcasm kind of stuff. Yeah.
Not everybody's drama. Good at physical humor either.
Right. Well, everybody has different strengths.
Right. So life. there's hundreds of reasons of why I wouldn't get, even if I was submitted for a project, why I wouldn't get an audition.
Right.
And so you understand, I have never gone to an audition. I will never go to an audition. I can barely remember the people's names in the room. Try to memorize lines. It ain't my capability.
That is the worst part of any audition, is having to take the time to memorize lines.
Yeah.
And just knowing that, like, you're going to finish it, and then there's pretty good chance you're never going to think of those lines that you just spent, like, an hour learning ever again.
A person that both of us, or all of us, respect, was relayed that I would be in the audition
room. He was told
this
story by another actor.
Oh, cool.
But that someone would ask the question in class, hey, oh, by the way, I heavily influenced my talent to go to class to get better.
Yeah.
Go to class, stretch your muscles, just like going to the gym. You're not going to run a marathon without training. Mm-hmm. You need to train as an actor. Anyways, so...
I don't know what you're talking about. I'm perfect.
Except for that freckle.
Right. Oh, man.
So one of the actors said, Perrin sends you to an audition. And
he gets you auditions.
But Perrin shows up and lands the role. And the instructor looked at them and said, no, Perrin's not an actor.
No, that's not happening at all.
Perrin will never do that. I don't know who you're talking about, but no. Me act in front of a camera for pay will not happen.
Right.
If you have a free role.
If you're like desperate for bodies.
Crowd, I need seven more people to show up.
We need human furniture.
Yes. I show up for the unpaid human furniture roles.
Yeah, for like... No, for the local directors, like LaRon will call or also, Ryan Belgart will call saying, I just need a body.
Yeah. Movies, and I was a body. Uncredited in both of them.
Just a body walking by.
I've been credited in two other movies for no pay. I was literally part of the crowd. But at the same time.
And it's just to help out.
You need those people in your life. You need those people on set. When you need 27,000 people in an image, you're not going to be able to
have those extras, man.
You're going to need.
Got to have those extras.
But
so
go ahead.
What is it? Well, this is actually a genuine question because like my knowledge only goes so far, but is there a difference between signing with a talent agency and signing with a specific agent? And if so,
it depends on if the agency has more than one agent.
In Oklahoma, no.
If you're talking like William Morris, or CAA,
and what market are they in?
They're in LA.
They're in LA.
Yeah. I mean, they're worldwide.
California.
They're worldwide, but those are the two. Just for history, William Morris is the oldest talent agency in the world.
Wow.
It was one of the first, and CAA was created by five members that left William Morris. And created their own agency.
Clearly, they didn't have all and of so they the have, luck to be, so it's only CAA and two other people.
Well, it's the California Artists Agency.
Oh, cool.
Or Creative Artists Agency, that's what it is. Nice. Creative Artists
Agency. Which is why they're not here.
Agency.
We're all not that creative.
We're not creative. but so they have hundreds of agents within, and they have a specific set of who they represent.
Oh, okay.
And under the same agency.
Under the same, you have
an
agent.
So you're signed with the agency, your agent.
But your agent
might not be the
is
same as what Brian's agent would be under the same agency.
Right. Because
he's getting booked for
he's right. male.
Looking role.
And sometimes they do it by demographic.
Really dumb characters.
Right. Sometimes it's like, well, I'm the kid. I'm the agent for kids. Mm-hmm. Or I'm the agent for females from 20 to 40. Or sometimes it's by demographic. I mean, I'm not as... It depends on how the agency wants to split it up.
Those agents have a minimum of 1,000 talent.
Right.
Yeah.
Once you
it's a shotgun.
Yeah. How big is y'all's roster at BK?
We try to keep BK right around 300.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, wow. Okay.
So we're boutique. The smallest of the three agencies in the state. Linda Lehman's the next biggest, and then Magna is the largest.
Nice. Yeah, I know Magna's been around for...
personal focus is I try to do about 30% television, 30% movie, and then 40% with commercial work.
Right.
Which is why you don't do as much commercial work.
I'm usually on the other side of the camera for those. Right. That's the tricky thing about my line of work. I have to
shuffle which direction you want to
juggle it.
But you only pay me when you're on the viewing side of the camera.
Yeah, yeah.
So...
When you're in front of the camera or your voice is being used.
Right.
Yes. But it is nice that you understand that I'm not going to try to take money from you when it isn't due me. And I will never approach you and say, hey, you were on set for this.
Yeah.
Yeah, you it's did like, see yeah, me on set, but I had a boom mic that day.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, okay. And I don't go chasing pennies like that.
Yeah.
Because of my military service and my VA disability, and I still work full time,
right,
in the aviation industry, and then I try to do this as my passion job, and that allows me to headhunt for better jobs for you as an actor, which will propel you into bigger roles further down the line.
Yeah,
this is definitely a marathon, not a sprint.
Right. Yeah.
And so when actors say you don't work BK full-time? No. Do you act full-time?
Right.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
And even so, like, I was a theater major as well. Not that I utilize that much anymore. But,
she's in front of the mic.
Yes, yes. This is all I get. Right here. Right here. But my professors always used to tell us, you know, the agent, if you're going to get an agent, they're not going to book you 90% of your jobs. That's on you. And the agent is going to book you a smaller percentage. And while you're getting, you know, those little jobs that you're getting that they're booking, okay, you're getting more known. You're getting out there. You're going to get bigger roles. And then that's how it expands. It's not like, boom, I have an agent and they're booking all of
and
my games
I'm
all the time.
And now I'm going to be famous.
Yeah, you still have to put the work in as an actor.
In. Yeah. You still have to go out there and meet people and network. And that doesn't, you can't just drop off and say,
it really is about
do the work for me.
Yeah. All it is about who you know.
Yeah.
This business.
The best part about me is I came in as the plus one.
Yeah.
I would be the eye candy on Shannon's shoulder. I never refer to myself any way other than that in this reference. Because we would go to Dead Center, and Shannon was the actor, and I had no affiliation with this industry.
So he watched people,
people, and I listened, and I learned who was the type of person I wanted to be around. Right. And I got to know the movers and shakers. And then it's fun to watch those people, now that I own an agency, how some people change who they are as they approach me, and some people are the same people.
Oh, you're somebody that can benefit me? Well, you're the best.
Now I see who smears that chocolate pudding on their nose and who tries to suck up to me. And I'm like, you didn't want to talk to me before. I don't want to talk to you now.
And you can even see that in auditions where how actors, you know, treat people within the audition process, like the greeter. How are you treating the person that is signing you in?
Because you better believe that the casting director is going to talks with their staff, and if somebody was really rude,
and that's such an important thing to think about. Like, if somebody is going to hire you and work with you 12 hours a day,
they want
you for up to 5 days a week, you know, up to 6 days a week, even. Yeah. Like, if you're a turd, why would they want to spend
days.
That much? Yeah, they're long and they're crazy,
and you
like
get
it's not sunshine and rainbows,
get,
people.
I don't want to get known as this actor that hey, where's the bathroom? Oh, it's over there. And then you flip your hair as if, thank you, and now I don't have any use for you anymore.
Yeah, now touch up my makeup, wench.
Thank you, invisible servant person.
And you don't know that crafty person
is the person that's going to get you further jobs later.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Yeah.
You don't want that reputation, which is why I always watch who the interaction with the people and how they treat other people. And I don't want to represent someone that has the flip your hair, I'm done with you.
Diva attitude.
The diva attitude. We're all here for a common goal.
Right.
We're all here to make Oklahoma film music industry better. And this is my segue into the questions that you asked about before
about the entrepreneurial spirit.
The entrepreneurial spirit in Oklahoma.
Yeah.
I'm not taking a check right now from this company. This is my marathon.
Yeah,
I put in anywhere from 20 to 60 hours a week in BK without pulling pennies. I pay my wife occasionally. I pay Leah.
Occasionally.
I pay my bills. But I'm not here to pay my mortgage off of the sweat equity of my talent.
Yeah, you're not getting rich on this at all.
Right.
I'm not getting anything off of this right now.
And it might grow, but that's
future. But
the purpose isn't to
right
make
now,
money. It's to grow the industry.
To grow the industry.
Right. It's much bigger than just making a buck.
Yeah.
And so when people ask me why I do this, it's like so that I can make your life better.
Right.
This isn't about shining the light on me, and that's why you asked, am I a gatekeeper? No, I will never be a gatekeeper. You, as a talent, you hold all the cards in this market.
Yeah.
There is no single person in this market that can shut you down or blackball you.
Mm. You do it to yourself.
You self-eliminate.
That is true. That is true, and it is painful / mildly entertaining to watch.
Yes. From the sidelines. I'm not going to lie. I'm a terrible person, and I really enjoy watching people explode.
I do.
Yeah.
I'm right there with you, Kelly. I'm right there with you.
It's really sad at the point where you watch someone spiral and self-implode.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And
I think
because it's
unnecessary.
And we don't want that here
ego.
Because we have, it is a smaller market. So we want to keep building it. You don't want these people. Like,
when one of us succeeds, it brings all of us up.
Right.
Yeah.
I really believe that. And so anyone who knows me knows that I'm very, very compassionate. I'm very, very encouraging to other actors because I don't see, even if there was another 6-foot redhead sitting next to me in the audition room, I don't see that person as competition. I see that person as a coworker, either a potential coworker on this project or on another project or just in general. That's a coworker, and I need to be pleasant and compassionate to that person in their process also because we are all in this
it's
together.
Hard, yeah.
And if I'm nasty.
Well, and I feel like when you're excited, like if you're on an audition, you know, and you're quote unquote competing against these other actors and you're excited for the person that wins the role.
Yeah.
Even if you didn't win the role, be excited for that person because
and
eventually it will be you.
Yeah. I get excited when I see who's walking in the door and I'm like, you have an audition. It's so exciting.
Yeah.
And I have to like, curb that down because, you know, I don't want to ruin their process or break their concentration, but
for
I get excited.
That don't act like myself. An actor has to get themselves into their character before an audition.
And especially
and
during those
that process starts hours ahead of time.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I know. I always have to remember that because I'm a huge chatterbox in the waiting room.
I am too. And I'm a hugger.
A lot of actors are like, I am running lines in my head right now. Like,
you need to step away. I know. I'm a huge hugger. And I'm like, and I have to like, I have to stop myself and go, I need to let
them
have
their
space.
Their
yes.
Yeah.
Not
and
hug, mug.
Mug them.
And you shouldn't, I mean, technically, you shouldn't be talking in the waiting room.
No, you shouldn't. You shouldn't. You do not want to disturb
the
anybody
that are
else.
Actually auditioning.
And you
yeah,
can just do
why.
Like the sort of like
walls.
Smile, wave, nod your head.
Yeah.
And that's enough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's enough for in the audition room.
You know that
be
you're all in
all
it together.
Effusive later outside. Give them hugs. So great
she
to see you because
word.
It's awesome when any actor gets an audition.
Yeah.
It really is because.
That's
I mean,
high stakes.
Success.
It's a high stakes game.
As
well,
a local casting
poker,
director says,
like.
That's a win.
It's a win. Yeah.
It's a win getting in the audition room. And that
an actor's career
should be celebrated.
Is auditioning.
Yes, an totally. Actor's choice. That's your job. Yeah, it's to audition.
It's auditioning, and let's be honest, actors can be a little fragile, and so we need to build up these sweet actors because sometimes they fall apart.
Well, and that's what I've been
there. Actors, your favorite television show wouldn't exist.
Yeah,
exactly.
Well, and if any of you follow BK's social media, it's at BK Talent Agency on Instagram and Twitter, and we have a Facebook page. But I am always trying to be very, very positive because when I look for quotes from other actors that we all would be, if they walked in the room, we'd be like on our knees going, oh my gosh, let me kiss your feet. They struggle, you know. Robert De Niro struggles. He gets told no.
Yeah, they all have bad auditions.
Meryl Streep gets told no.
Yeah.
Well, and the other thing is that those people still have to audition.
Yeah. Yes. They're not all exempt the time. From the policy of like, hey, they are still you have good
to
for this role?
Lobby. Yeah. They still have to convince directors that they're right for the role.
Yeah.
That's still a process, even when they reach that level that we think, oh my gosh, it's godlike.
Yeah.
They still struggle. And so we're not unique. And I you're not alone. Actors out there struggling.
You're not alone.
Feeling that self-doubt.
And if you don't win that role, it's not personal. You are not alone.
Yeah. It's not personal. Not booking the job is not personal.
Yeah.
No.
Not getting the audition is not personal.
Yeah.
It's all business. It really is a business. And a casting director is not going to call someone in that, while they may have a lot of respect for them as an actor and as a person, if they're wrong for the role,
they're wrong. That's it.
Mm-hmm. They're not going to call them in because that makes them look bad to the production. Why are you wasting my time with this audition? We had a conversation that this 6-foot redhead is not what I'm looking for. It's not personal.
Yeah.
It's business.
I just want to see that one casting director that doesn't cast because it is personal.
I was going to say, I would love to do a sketch now of just the wrong person for the role.
Yes, bring him in real quick. Bring him in. Yeah. Yes.
Maybe we should do that as part of
I just wanted you to know that I hate you. Not your performance.
It is personal. You.
Everything about you. Spectacular.
Yeah.
Although, however.
You look like my ex-wife's boyfriend that I stepped in on while they were bumping up.
Exactly. So for the record, I thought you nailed the acting part, but everything about your face I hate. On a deep personal level. Get out. I'm about to hurl right in your shoes.
If I had the
whole grenade of
Antioch, I would throw it at you. Yeah. After counting to 5. Yeah. Wait, no, 3.
Yeah. We should do that sketch. We should make that a thing.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
So let's talk a little bit about the entrepreneurial spirit, because that's, I was, to catch the listeners up, I was talking to Perrin about a conversation that I'd had with,
Go ahead and name drop. Go ahead.
Well, so the band Pentatonix, I got to work with Kevin. Turns out he's a super nice guy. And
what
like,
was the project?
We were shooting, we were filming a thing for NPR.
Awesome.
Let that set in. We were filming a thing for NPR. National Public Radio. Filming.
Tiny Desk Concert? No.
No.
Not that.
But so I was working with Kevin, and he and I started having a really cool conversation about the entrepreneurial spirit of being a performance artist. And like, I don't think enough people think about that aspect of doing this. A lot of times people think that, well, I'm just going to get a talent agent, and then it's going to be sunshine and rainbows after I do a couple auditions. I'm going to be famous.
You might as well find a unicorn while you're there.
Yeah, yeah, and win the lottery, too.
Right.
And like he was talking about, and this is a guy who the Pentatonix are very successful now.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
And like he was talking about how there are a lot of a cappella bands out there, there's only one Pentatonix. And the reason that there is only one Pentatonix is because they have an entrepreneurial spirit and they know how to play the game of entrepreneurship to reach their goals. And like I just think that's such a fascinating way to look at this. A lot of people have if we're being brutally honest, have their heads up in the clouds.
Yes. They're following their passion.
A plus B equals famous.
Yeah, right.
And it's just not that way.
Nope.
In this industry, even people that have made really great films, as soon as that film is off the screen, they fade to black again.
Yeah.
Yeah. And if they don't...
Unless you're M. Night Shyamalan, who is fighting, kicking, and screaming.
Down to the grave.
Have anyone seen it?
I've already seen reviews of Glass, and it looks bad.
I will see it anyway.
By the time this by the time this episode comes out, Glass is going to be like, you know.
By the time this episode comes out, we will have recorded the second episode where I'm like, it was bummers.
Yeah. This is the alternative version of like, I mean, it was perfect. It was a great movie.
Yeah.
So I want to ask her this because as an actor, this is kind of, it gets very frustrating when I watch other actors make these same mistakes. It would be great if we could just be creative artists and life would be awesome. And we just got to do our art all the time without having to really make any effort or do anything about it. But that's not reality. No. It's just not. So
you're David Lee Anderson.
Well, he's just awesome.
He's a really good local artist for those of you that haven't seen his great work.
I call him a Renaissance man.
Yeah, he's really great.
He's awesome.
I represent him too.
But as an actor, now the business part of it, if you're like, well, what is the business part? So I need to make sure that my product, which is my acting, is as top-notch as possible.
Go to the gym. Go to class.
Which means I need to, when I'm not on set, I need to be in class.
Mm-hmm.
Read a book.
And what does that do for me as an actor? Well, it gets me to play. I get to play.
Mm-hmm.
I get to try new things, not in an audition room where they might fail and I might lose the job, but where I get to try new things and stretch my muscles and work with other actors I haven't had a chance to work with, which can really bring out some things in me that I didn't even realize. And I will often take the same class over and over because I change as an actor over time. So my experience in that class will be different. And the class members are different.
Yeah.
So I am always in class. And I get itchy between the shoulder blades when I'm not in class.
For the record, I have yet to get anything but a handshake from Chris Fryhofer.
Or Michelle DeLonge.
Right. Or OCCC or any of the other OU.
Yeah.
And all of those are on my website of where you should go to for a class.
Yeah. Well, and that's great. Let's touch on the resources. I said that really weird. On the resources on the website.
Touch on the resources.
Yes.
www.
In the laboratory.
Agency.com. Yes.
Yes.
There's a resources tab there.
Yeah. And you guys have some really, really handy tools that are right there, whether you're on the talent agency or not.
Which that's an amazing thing because I remember coming right out of college back in years ago. But all I know is I was searching the internet going like, I'm moving to Edmond. Where in Oklahoma City? Where can I take classes? I'm Googling the weirdest combination of words like actor class, talent agent mixed with monologue perform, you know, just anything I could find to know what is available because I wanted to know where it was. And so having a list.
I also have to plug Michelle and
Axe.
She does one-on-one mentoring.
And she does have classes sometimes.
And she'll bring improv there. There's tons of,
Well, the space, isn't the space doing
there
right stuff
now?
There?
Yes. Yeah, the space. The sketch comedy's there now. So the space, excellent.
And
freaking great.
And she's really, I mean, I go to her for individual coaching on some of my stuff and she tapes and Chris Fryhofer's tapes.
Yeah, you get headshots and all the things.
Oh, I have a list of people that do awesome headshots.
Yeah.
Yes. And we also have on there because Brylan Gilliland has started a new business where he, you know, Prairie Dog Creative will, you know, film your demo reel. So all you actors out there who need a demo reel.
And I actually, you guys reached out to me
as soon as I
putting
heard
that on the website.
Yeah, as soon as I heard that you were doing that, I was like, we need this on the resources.
I think that happened within like 45 seconds.
Well, that's one thing that occurred to me. To catch the listeners up. So I produce, if you need a demo reel, but you don't have any footage because you haven't been casting anything. What is a demo reel?
Let's ask the agent.
Demo reel is an example of your acting work, and it needs to look like a scene from an actual show where you are on screen with someone else. Well, they don't have to have actually someone else exactly, but you need to be reacting to someone speaking to you. Stage acting is all about memorization, which is often why they use monologues.
Right.
Because it shows that you can memorize long bits of lines and be able to present them. Film acting is about your facial reactions to what someone else is saying. So sending a monologue in as your demo reel is not...
It's not going to work.
Good.
My favorite scene of a monologue, or sorry, of a reel, Shannon does a comedy one where her husband's doing something in the kitchen and not paying any attention to her, and she's doing her makeup, and he's like, Shannon's like, honey, we're going to go out. Uh-huh, okay. And the husband just completely blows her off. Yeah, we're going to go out and be, I'm going to go out and cougar it up.
And
for those of you that know Shannon, that's not her personality.
Yeah.
So it's great acting, but the husband just, have fun with the girls. And that's awesome. Just continues to play it up, and it's a great reel.
Yeah.
But the reaction of the husband, who is also a great actor, and this is her first reel, and
it was one of my first.
And
yeah.
It's,
I look at it now, and hilarious. I'm like, oh.
I think everyone's critical of their own acting,
and
sure.
You're like, but you need the reel. You need like a, and especially one with like transitions that are a little bit clean. You want
someone
you want it to look technically sound, because I think like I'm putting myself on the other end of the camera, like those shoes. Yeah. Like if you see a demo reel that it's obvious that this was just like a group of kids that shot this on a weekend, like what you're casting for is a larger scale thing with a full crew and all that kind of stuff, that doesn't necessarily scream experienced.
Yeah. And that's the other part.
What a demo reel can do. We had a commercial come out and it paid a stupid amount of money and it was demo only.
Hmm.
So they wanted to see the quality of work that you had
before they decided about auditioning you.
Oh, wow.
Which your headshot makes you money. Mm-hmm. Your reel made money. In this case, it was a large airline, American Airlines.
Yeah.
And I think that one was like $6,000.
For the principal.
For the principal role.
It went to someone from Dallas.
And it went to someone from Dallas.
Oh, for sure.
Who had a better.
But they paid $700 for a half day for supporting roles. And those were also cast off of demo reels only.
Oh, interesting.
Wow.
So that's a big deal. Like having good quality.
Not having a demo reel eliminated at that time.
A lot of people.
We had people asking, when can we get a demo reel? And we didn't have your asset available yet.
Or where do we go?
Oh, yeah. So now if you need scenes, but you haven't actually been cast in anything, you can hit me up on our social media, Okishosha, whatever, and I'll actually produce a little scene for you.
Right. It'll be custom made. It can't be anything that's already copywritten, so it has to be unique to this scene. And
it's also why you don't use sides that you've had in auditions, because those are copywritten.
Get yourself in trouble.
You could get yourself in trouble. So there are sites online, unless you write it yourself, there are sites online that have. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and there are sites online.
Open source, right? Yeah.
There's open sources. Yeah. And there's some really great stuff on there, scenes that are not copywritten, that are considered, you know, public domain. But
that's right, because you have to like register scripts and stuff.
Right.
Right.
So don't take a scene. Well, I really like this character. Don't take that scene. Those sides. Because if you read the information, because whenever Michelle or Chris sends me sides, there's always that blurb.
Here she is name dropping again.
That says that the use of these sides is for this audition only.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So by printing these sides, you agree to that.
Yeah.
And so don't use them, please. Don't use your previous audition videos.
It's always really
videos.
Fun whenever you get your sides, or like if you win a role and you get the copy of your scenes and stuff, they always have your name on
all
the sides emblazoned on it. So if you leak pages,
they know who done it.
I have to tape an audition tomorrow and it's my name's printed on
there. And it's a little scary. It's like they know.
Like,
yeah.
My name's on it.
Yeah. That was...
Yeah. Yeah, they do that. and more they're doing that because they don't want stuff leaked. So,
especially if it's a larger.
So we've bounced around. So as an actor, the business side is making sure my product is good, which also includes my demo reels, making sure I have good quality demo reels. If I don't have footage from previous productions, which unless it's in your contract, production does not have to give you footage.
Or credit on...
Or credit.
So on the business front end of that, that's something that you
would it's something that if it's really important, you make that known to your agent, and it can be added into a contract. That's something that an agent will take care of.
So that's something an agent would do for you that you might not be able to handle on your own.
Right.
Yeah. And also your name in the credits. If it's not in the contract IMDb. Ahead of time, you're not getting your
name.
It's
not guaranteed.
Specific.
It's not guaranteed. So if you get all fussy about it, it's like, why am I not in the IMDb page? It's like, unless it was specifically said in the contract that you will get your name in there.
Yeah.
Then
there is an amount of proactiveness that you as the actor.
And as an actor, you need, like, I need a good headshot. Mm-hmm. I need a good resume. I need a good demo reel. I need my acting skills on point. But I also need to read the contracts and understand.
And take a picture of them.
What's there and take a picture of them and protect myself, because my agent's not on set with me. They don't like magically know what's going on.
I don't get to send a copy unless you took a picture and sent it.
So I need to understand. So I need to learn and understand what a dude is and how to read it, which is a days out of days. A schedule of the shooting and shows where, what locations and what scenes are going to be shooting at that location and who's going to be needed and all of that. I need to know as an actor how to read that. That is not the responsibility of the agent to teach you. You as the actor need to know. There are classes that you can take that
explain those. I mean, not just in colleges, but there, I mean, outside of there are classes that will give you a description. Yeah. This is what this is, and this is how you read it.
And you know what? While you're in class with either Michelle or Chris or Daryl or Cato or any of the instructors out there, ask.
Mm-hmm. They'll tell
you. Ask the question. Because as an actor, you need to understand that you cannot allow an agent to be the only person who understands this, because then you will, when you move to a larger market and there are less scrupulous agents, you will get screwed. Mm-hmm. Literally.
Let's go figuratively and less literally.
Well, I don't know, the way Hollywood's been going lately.
That might be
Kevin's
literally
out of this conversation.
Yeah.
But seriously, I mean, that's the business of it. It's the boring part. It's the part you don't get paid for. It's not the part that's fun, but
it's really important.
Pay your agent.
In the appropriate region.
Well, let's touch on that real quick. Cause like, what is the, you know, I think beginning actors sometimes see that percentage and they're like, what? They're taking my money.
Well, SAGs caps it on all SAG projects at 10%. Non-union stuff.
That is specifically for Screen Actor Guild.
SAG-AFTRA
projects that are SAG, and they pay and play specific by list and rules. And there's so many pay scales on so many websites that you need to get knowledgeable on.
As an actor, go to SAG-AFTRA.org.
Yes, you can print out all the rules, whole booklet.
Or I think it is .org, but it might be .com. I may be misremembering that. But SAG-AFTRA, now some of it's confusing. It's taken me, especially the commercial scale sheet. Oh my gosh!
Yeah,
if you're like on
as long
camera,
as I've been doing this, I still don't understand.
It's like, okay, if you're on camera but you're 5 feet from the camera, you get this one. If you're 10 feet, you get this one. If we have you juggle, we give you this much more money.
You're holding an musical instrument.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Yeah. So when you ask your agent, well, how much am I getting? It's like, we have no idea. Because it's whatever they ask.
Were you wearing a red wig?
Yes.
In that case, whatever they ask you.
Polka dots?
Yeah.
No? It's crazy. So the film stuff is a lot more easy to understand for me.
And then you do your local non-union work is... Yeah, by SAG rules, you can only pay your agent 10%. I take 15%.
Non-union, there is no regulation. Non-union.
There is no requirement. There is no standard across the industry. Some take 15, some take 20. There is no hard, fast rule.
No.
If you are a SAG signatory agency, which Oklahoma has none because we don't have an Oklahoma SAG office. Dallas has SAG agents, which if you're a SAG actor, you have to be with a SAG agent.
And they're only allowed to have SAG actors, I think.
Yeah.
SAG actors work within the agency. It's a whole political thing, but we don't play by those rules here in Oklahoma. But
because we is that because we are a right to work state?
Because we
Texas is a right to work state also, but we don't have enough SAG actors to create SAG only agencies
in the state.
And they do a minimum of three, three agencies. They don't just pick one. They do a minimum of three agencies of signatory agencies.
So if all roughly 2,000 actors in Oklahoma became SAG tomorrow, there still wouldn't be enough actors to bring SAG in.
Gotcha. So and that actually brings me, this is kind of a sidebar question, but I think it's a really important question for anybody that has been acting and they finally gain SAG eligibility. That means that they can go full SAG.
Which you and I both are.
We're finally SAG eligible.
Like it's when I reminded you that, by the way, he's on True Detective.
Premieres tonight.
Yes. Episode 5.
So those of you listening to this, you can go back and look at it. Anyways.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
there's future a lot past. Of Back to the Future things going on.
But yeah, when I reminded him of that, he was like, dang.
Yeah. I was like, hadn't realized
that.
That was a hoot.
Ask your question.
If you're SAG eligible, that doesn't always necessarily mean that you want to get
According to the union, we're still non-union.
Okay.
Right.
SAG so if doesn't you are look at you as union, but you're eligible
for to SAG. Join.
To join, okay. But in Oklahoma, by being SAG eligible, all that does is when a SAG project comes in, they say we're going to play by all the SAG rules. If they hire a non-SAG eligible actor, they have to pay a $75 penalty for hiring and fill non-union out Taft-Hartley paperwork, which is a lawsuit.
Which was a lawsuit against not an acting union, but it affected SAG-AFTRA. But it was actually, I think it was against the coal union or the steel union.
It's part of
that. But it was basically because it was that double standard where you couldn't get a union job without union job experience.
But you right. couldn't,
but you couldn't get union job experience without having a union job.
Yeah.
So it was this
catch-22.
Yeah. So it's all so Taft-Hartley
sued the unions.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why it's called, that's why SAG just calls it the Taft-Hartley after the Taft-Hartley Act in the lawsuit, which allows a production, as far as for film, allows a SAG production to hire a non-union actor if a union actor is not available for that role.
Right.
If you're in California, why they pay a penalty. You can do a maximum of three roles before you are mandated to become SAG.
Mm.
So you get the first one that you Taft-Hartley did.
And you get a free second one.
Second. And then the third one, you have to run a third.
You have to join
in
on the third.
In the state of Oklahoma, there is no benefit to joining SAG.
That's a big thing because I know a lot of guys. Well, a lot of guys. I know a handful of people that have become SAG eligible and they get all psyched.
Frustrating.
And then they go full SAG, thinking that they've my career is going to take off. And then they can't work.
It limits your work. Yep.
Yeah.
Because by union rules, it's called Golden Rule One. By union rules, you cannot work on a non-union project. However. Oklahoma actors, listen up. There is a thing called an OPO, a one production only, that for our region, now if you call New York office or LA office and ask questions about an OPO, they'll think that you have gone crazy. Call Dallas, because Trish down there knows what's going on.
And the other nice people that work with Trish.
Because she's the executive director of SAG down in Dallas. She's our representative as actors for she's SAG actors. Nice she's people. Awesome.
Yeah. Trish Avery?
I think so, Trish Avery.
Yeah.
And an OPO production has to fill it out because the signatory, the person who's paying the checks, who signs the checks, has to fill out the paperwork.
Yeah.
And that basically is a...
It's a sheet and a half.
Yeah, it's... less than 2 pages, and it's a guarantee that the actor will get paid.
That's all it is.
Nice.
That's all it is.
So then if you're SAG and they fill that
and they fill out
you
that,
are then you able to work on a non-role,
so non-union Brian project.
On that project.
He's shooting a short, and he wants to use a SAG actor.
Mm-hmm.
He has to apply. If he's the one with the money, he has to apply for a OPO
for that actor.
For that actor to be able to work your non-union project.
That's good to know.
As an example, for all you individual filmmakers, you can ask the Burns brothers how easy this was, because on Shifter, Lisa Nidell is a SAG actor, and they had to fill out an OPO for her to be in their project.
Really? So,
really super, super easy. And Trish will walk you through it. Well, anyone at the office will walk you through it and help you get it. So for you SAG actors out there who want to do non-union stuff, there is hope.
Right.
There is hope.
It's because not a death sentence. SAG is
starting to realize that by region, the needs of the actors are not always the same.
Right.
And so they're starting to adjust to that.
That's good. That's good to hear, because it's what I have always come to understand is, like, just stay SAG eligible. Just stay that way until you decide to move to a larger market. Yeah. Then until go full SAG.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've been told that until they make me, until they say you can't step on set without being SAG.
Yeah.
Then, you know,
fine.
Yeah. So, for all
the new actors that are really excited and be like, I want to make it.
SAG.
Hold on. Slow down. Yeah.
Also,
wait a second.
Join SAG before you leave Oklahoma.
It's cheaper.
For the love of God.
It's $3,100 in California to join SAG. It's $1,100.
Repeat that louder.
$3,100 to join SAG in California. They actually have no interest loans that you can apply for to join SAG in California. $1,100 to join if you're an Oklahoma resident.
That's insane.
And so. Still in the state.
And still in the state.
Get it, and then
do
get going.
It. That's,
get it, and then
that's cool.
Move.
Yeah, that's very
that's
cool.
A wonderful thing. I did not
and
know
that's
that.
That's new.
Wow.
Yeah, because that's I think they're trying to encourage more of us regional actors to join SAG, more of us, because there are a lot of us who are SAG eligible and not joining the union, and the union asked why.
Why? And they're like, well, we need the roles.
Yeah.
And so expensive. That's why they came out with the OPO, and then it's expensive, so they reduced.
See, that's great that SAG is actually working and listening. Like, that's really, that's cool to hear.
I think that's good for Oklahoma, the of us here,
For sure. Yeah. So we're gonna move on to a game in just a second, but I want to ask you guys one last thing, which is what... What should the beginning actor not do? This is always a fun question.
to do?
One tip from the actor, one tip from the agent.
What not to do?
Back and forth.
Lightning round.
Yeah.
Be reasonable about what your talents actually are. Be realistic.
Yeah.
Self-critical if you need to be. I mean, don't tear yourself down. Don't be like, I'm the worst actor ever. But... be realistic, because I've met some really bad actors who think they are God's gift.
Yeah.
And I'm like, this is so, they're so deluded that there's no getting to it. So be humble, because really we are all in this together. We're a bunch of goofballs getting together trying to make stuff.
And there's nothing wrong with being a goofy looking person, looking in the mirror and saying, you know what?
Of it.
I don't think I'm ever going to play Logan.
Just be aware that you're not.
I am never
going to
be the leading lady. I'm always a character. I'm going to be the character actor. I'm okay with that. Why?
Because
I
get to act. So much more fun.
Because you get to act.
Yeah.
I get to do what I love. And then you get, guess what? If you're in that niche role, stay there because you get jobs.
Yeah.
Anyway,
if you're 40, don't think that you look like a teenager. So be realistic.
Unless you do look like a teenager, in which case, there you go.
But
lucky
be realistic.
You.
Be realistic.
For me, pay your agent what your agent is due. And don't fight with your agent. No, you didn't land me this job. The contract says if you have paywork in the state of Oklahoma, you're paying your agent because your agent does all this stuff for you with no compensation. I can't tell you how many jobs I've submitted people for with zero compensation. I've submitted you for countless projects that
they didn't come.
They
out.
Went they... with someone else because you look like the thousand reasons why you didn't land the role.
Yeah.
But when you do land a role for anything, pay your agent for the region that you're in. Some people have multiple agents. So pay the agent that is appropriate for the project that is
where the project's shot. Now, I do want to say that an agency, here's some red flags for the new actor as far as getting an agent, is no agent should ask for money up front.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Which, that can be sketchy.
the for real pay to play.
Right.
Yeah.
There's Some agents have their favorite, like, headshot person or whatever. Of if it's an in-house and you're paying your agent for the headshots, that sounds a little sketchy. That sounds a little sketchy. If they're, if your agent is like, you have to take my acting classes, that's sketchy. If you're paying,
if your acting classes are online only through their agency, red flag.
Also, an agency by regulation, I don't know if, what law it is, but an agency can only have exclusivity within 200 miles or 300 miles from 250
miles from their brick and mortar
from location. Their brick and mortar location, which for us is Midwest City, which almost includes pretty much includes the entire state. We don't take Texas, Dallas, because we just use a state line.
It fits within the geography, but we just take the state.
So if you have an Atlanta agent that is like saying you got yourself a job in Oklahoma and they're saying you have to pay, they may not be able to enforce that unless there's something in their contract that does.
Right.
But so we're exclusive only for BK, only for the state of Oklahoma. And if we negotiate the contract for an out-of-state job, you owe us for
that's
that.
That's a separate thing. But you do that's owe not us. Just because like an automatic. That's work that was like done. If I were, I get booked in California, you're like, pay me now. unless that's negotiated or something.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. If I get a phone call from someone in California, hey, I need X person. Yeah.
Which has
to
happened.
Come to California, do a live performance, do a video performance, whatever. I'm going to pay their travel. I'm going to pay their lodging. I'm going to pay their performance fee. I only take my percentage off the performance fee, not off the per diem, not off the travel, not off the hotel fees, nothing else. And that's the way
it should be. If your agent negotiates it, if they do the work, they should get paid. But anytime you're in front of the camera, the agent should get paid. Because there's a lot of work that the agency does, and I did not realize it until I started helping Billy out, how much work. Because I mean, anyone can say that they have texted me at like 2 a.m. thinking, oh, I just remembered this question. And I respond. within like 10 minutes.
Sorry.
I'm sending texts at 6 in the morning before I go to my aviation job.
Yeah.
I'm sending out messages.
I mean, I'm on the.
And you guys really do say, I can say as an actor on BK, like you guys do a really good job of like staying on top of everything.
Questions.
And like one thing I really appreciate about you guys, not just staying on top of like getting information to me, but making sure that I do my job in like responding and doing that kind of, I really appreciate that.
Like, Ryan, are you available for this voice acting role that this church wants to hire you for?
I mean, I guess.
Oh, yeah. I need that tonight.
Okay. Yeah.
Check in 5 minutes later. Yeah. Just making sure you're doing it.
And there's been like, I've had people have problems with their CMLs, which are casting mails from the Actors Access that says, hey, you got an audition. And I will, if I haven't heard from people, I will be like sending them text messages. Hey, did you check your CMail?
Your CMail yet?
Well, you got an audition. So you better go get that.
I appreciate that, man. Because especially like just speaking from my...
Actors Access is kind of confusing. Sorry.
It is really confusing
for me,
sometimes.
Casting
networks is worse.
Casting networks is so much worse.
Those of you that don't know what those two companies are...
You must prove yourself worthy.
Most roles come through for our region.
Even the local casting directors here in Oklahoma post their jobs on there because it allows them to organize the auditions in such a way that it's easier to, give to
it
production.
Has tools on the backside for their life to be.
So
easier.
Don't be thinking that we only use Actors Access it's because the casting directors use Actors Access.
Right. So you need
and casting
network. I wish they would just make an app already. Like
it would be.
Does Actors Access have an app yet?
I don't know.
I don't think so. Yeah, because it's
always like Casting Networks is like from the
85
It feels like it, yeah. But I always appreciate the reminder emails from you guys of like, hey, you should respond to that email. It's like,
Hey, Brian, have you checked your email yet?
Sorry.
I will call people. I will
Smiley
text
face
people.
At the end.
But again,
if there's enough time,
responsibility does fall on the actor.
On the actor.
You
stay
guys
on top of your
nice.
Emails. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm just because I want you guys to work.
You
want to
get work. Yeah, exactly.
And
as an
actor, I life can get pretty hectic and I may not.
One other thing I want to talk about is the slow time.
Anyway, life can get hectic And it's hard to keep on top of your emails sometimes. And every year, okay, actors, every year there is a slow time. Happens every year. They so when it happens.
So I am right now.
If it happens, when it happens, and it, I always, I start getting text messages, I start getting emails.
Panic mode.
Do you guys hate me?
I get phone
What's
calls.
Wrong?
How come I haven't been submitted
What is
for
typically
this?
The slow season that you guys experience? Because I experience it with Separately technical from, stuff, like the technical
it
jobs.
It happens about the same time, although with auditions, sometimes it picks up a little earlier than than crew
I'm
stuff.
Always curious if there's like a fluctuation there.
It fluctuates to right before Thanksgiving to sometimes right after Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
Because sometimes people will work through that Thanksgiving weekend and be like,
I've noticed like,
screw you, family.
As soon as the holidays come around,
you don't need any
that's
more
the
turkey.
Other reason why I'm always, that's the other reason why I'm always very excited for the holidays to end, to call back to the very beginning of this.
Because money starts.
There's no jobs during
There's
the
no
holiday
jobs.
Season.
There's no jobs for about a month and a half to 2 months. It's like the last couple weeks of November to about the first 2 weeks of January. There are no jobs.
Yeah.
In fairness, it's too cold to shoot.
It is.
The weather outside is too unpredictable.
It's frightful.
To plan. You don't want to reschedule shoot dates around
That's
snowstorms.
That's expensive. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes.
It's $1,000 a minimum a day just for the set
reservation.
And then you start adding
and
up
it's
all
dangerous.
Everything else.
I mean, you have, you have
the weather is dangerous. It's hard to get actors because they have family obligations that they would like, screw you, I have family. Yeah. And some actors would be like, screw you, family. But more actors than not.
Those are the ones that are truly dedicated.
More actors than not are hard to schedule during the holidays because they're traveling or they're, you know, they're doing family stuff. So that's the slow time.
Yeah.
It's picking up again. I think Leah, who's awesome, by the way, Leah sent out like 15 casting calls one day.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Because they all hit at the same time. I was like,
she was... She was in Canada.
She's in Canada. She flies back tomorrow.
When you hear this, she'll be back. But she sends out emails on my behalf anywhere from 15 to 20 a day sometimes.
Wow.
Yeah. And if you're not getting, they're like, oh, I don't get 15 to 20 emails. It's because we.
You don't fit the demographic.
We only send.
6 to 9 year old child.
Nothing personal.
BK only sends it to the people who fit the breakdown. Because I wouldn't want to have to sift through 15, 20 to find one that I fit.
Because I'm not part of them. I don't know how
they're awesome. But I mean, I talked to Taylor, who works over at Magna, who's awesome. Hi, Taylor. she does the same job I do. And
she's their office manager.
She's their office manager. And yeah. We have stories. Oh my gosh, so many stories.
Yeah,
and we laugh so much sometimes. We don't give names, so don't be thinking that we're like bad mouthing people. But we'll be like, oh yeah, this actor called the other day and was just like, yeah. So we have
what a
fun.
Diva.
We have
she flipped her hair on the phone.
Yeah. She was a horrible actor on the phone with me.
It's like So yeah. Anyway, a couple other things for actors I just want to get out there to remember is that when working, we're talking about SAG and the guarantee of money. SAG, when they have a project, when they approve a project, that project has to put the money to pay the actors into escrow before the movies or the project starts filming.
Non-union work, however, there is no guarantee in this state that you will ever be paid in a timely manner.
No.
Yeah.
And if the state of Oklahoma...
6 months, 8 months, 9 months. State of Oklahoma has 7 different tiers of payment.
Process to process the invoice.
So net 360.
Yeah.
Expect those to take a lot longer.
And by law, you have to give 45 days for the payment from the first invoice, and then you have to give a second invoice to give another 45 days. So by law, we have to give 90 days anyway.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So don't call your agent at 60 days and say, hey, how come I
Because we
seen my
are sent, believe me, I am sending reminders. I am having him call. I am, because
yes,
he can be.
I listen to my wife.
He can be intimidating.
Yeah. Out there. Happy spouse, happy house.
Mm-hmm.
There you go.
Happy life, happy wife, or which way?
Yeah, happy wife, happy life.
Both directions.
Yeah. But I just wanted to.
There's nothing that rhymes with husband.
Yes. Yeah. But happy husband, no one cares.
No.
But yeah, ask lots of questions. And if you're confused, just ask. Because, I mean, that's any agent should be.
Yeah.
You know, anybody, go ask other actors. Oh, I also wanted to, one of my pet peeves, because on your intake thing is like, what are your pet peeves? I was like, the trash talking that actors do in holding is just, it's getting out of control.
Don't be competitive, man. There's no need for it.
Be internally competitive.
Yeah.
Have that drive inside. You're competing with yourself. And don't let it barf out of your mouth towards other people.
Do what everybody else does and save it for Twitter.
Yeah. Go home and gripe to your dog.
Yeah.
That's what the dog's for. It's like my
you may be
dog.
Sitting there bad-mouthing one of the other agents, and that actor is like, well, that's my agent. And you're just making another actor feel bad.
Yeah, and you're making and fool that's, yourself.
Yeah,
too.
that doesn't make for a
I
very
always feel like
nice coworker.
I feel like whenever somebody is talking trash on somebody else, the person who looks bad is not the person that the trash talking is about.
Yeah.
It's the person doing the trash talking.
Yeah.
That everyone is like, I think you're kind of a jerk.
Yeah.
So.
Because, I mean, you may be frustrated.
Keep it to
but
yourself.
Yeah. So it's just. Anyway, that's just something that's my pet peeve is
those are good
trash
tips.
Talking.
Good tips.
Trash talking is getting out of control, people. Come on.
Well, you guys want to play a game?
Sure.
Do we need to talk about SoonerCon?
Yeah. Oh, yes. Let's talk about SoonerCon real quick.
We have to skip a game. We got to talk about SoonerCon.
All right. Let's talk. Let's touch on SoonerCon real quick.
Trixie's, that's my game.
SoonerCon. So, Per and I are both geeks at heart, and so I started volunteering. I wanted to go to a con, and I can never afford it. So you know what I did? I volunteered.
Yeah, buddy.
And now I'm like staff. And so it's
like, yeah. I volunteered, and now I'm on the board.
Nice. Yeah.
FSCOK Overseas SoonerCon. I am the board. I am on the board this year and got talked into running for the board again next year. So and, not just volunteer, I am on the board of trustees.
And I also volunteer for Dead Center. Yay, I'm a screener. So all you actors are like, I still want to go to Dead Center, but I can't afford the film festival.
Volunteer.
Yeah.
Volunteer.
Well, and plus those volunteers like really make that.
Volunteer for Red Dirt. Volunteer for the Clean Shorts. Yeah. Volunteer. So anyway, we have some awesome stuff just to hit on. SoonerCon 28 is going to be on the same weekend as Dead Center. I know when they gave me the news, I cried. It's on June 7th through 9th. So, you know.
The cool thing is you can go see a movie and then you can cosplay over at SoonerCon.
Or you can go see a movie In cosplay,
which would be the best. Yeah,
that would be awesome. So, and we have moved. We are no longer going to be in Midwest City in our cramped Reed Center. We are at MBC Suites.
I love MBC Suites.
In Norman.
Yeah. Over 100% increase in our space.
That's awesome.
Oh my gosh. The Exhibitors Hall. Huge.
Well, and this last year, SoonerCon was packed.
It was so packed.
We had over 2,000 people there every day.
Yeah.
It was like going on a New York subway. You're like, excuse me.
So Brian and I have some con experience.
We have con experience, yes.
In our history, in our convoluted pasts. We performed improv at conventions.
Yes.
Many a time. So.
Boy, howdy. Those are some of the coolest fans, though. The funnest audiences to play for.
I would love to be an actor on one of those shows and just do cons for the rest of my life.
I'll get you. I'll get you on, girl. I have connections.
So, but do not despair. 2019 is the only year that SoonerCon is going to be on the same weekend. 2020, we're going to be back at our regularly scheduled end of the month.
Before.
Yeah. So what kind of guests do you guys
have? Oh, my gosh, you guys. So if you are a bibliophile.
That's a lover of books for those of you that don't like such
even the
words.
Word makes bibliophile. Me happy. It makes you shiver.
I'm a bibliophobe.
We have Kevin J. Anderson coming. So
Dune, Star Wars, Superman, X-Files, and many other books.
Nice.
Saga of the Seven Sons.
Oof.
I know.
That's awesome. Mufasa.
Our artist guest of honor is Julie Dillon. She's a Hugo and Chelsea Award winner. And
that's awesome.
So, a couple of voice.
Will also be on file. And
in the art show. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Voice actors.
Yeah.
Listen up.
We got Austin Tyndall
from Tokyo Ghoul, My Hero Academia.
Oh,
nice. That's Academia. A big one. Sorry.
My Hero
Academia. Fairy Tale, Attack on Titan. My girls, when they heard Ooh. These, they're like, oh. Yeah, they're starting to fan themselves.
11-year-old yeah. daughter, 9-year-old daughter, drop jaw on the floor. Went, oh. Yeah.
We also have Sarah Wiedenheft. I want to say it the German way, which is Wiedenheft, but it's Wiedenheft.
She's very American.
Yeah.
She's
Dragon Ball American. Super 100, Grimgar of Fantasy, and Ash. Mm. So she's also. So much
fun. These conventions are so much fun. We did a live show at last year's SoonerCon, and it was a freaking blast because we actually played D&D live.
Yeah, it was awesome.
It was so much fun. It was so much fun.
Oh, the game room, guys. The game room is going to have air conditioning this year. No more huge fans blowing air pieces all over the world. There you go.
20-sided die.
And it's twice as big. The game room is going to be twice as big. So for all of you guys coming. Matt Frank. I was getting there.
Okay.
Matt Frank, he's a returning guest from last year. And for all of you who like... you know, manga and he's a kaiju artist, does Godzilla.
Oh, that's awesome.
Commercial illustrator.
He goes back, they fly him to Japan twice a year so that he can spend time there and wander around and go, okay. And he writes all the kanji all the characters because he spends time there. The Japanese people appreciate his art so much that they actually fly him at their expense back for cons.
Wow.
And he has friends over there. And so
he's constantly in Japan.
Understands the culture better than most.
His art is so... I follow him on Facebook, and his art is so awesome. So and I'm not cool. a huge Godzilla fan. Oh, I mean, I like...
So the reason why we're so familiar with all these Japanese things, we spent 4 years in the military
in Japan.
Northern Japan.
Oh, wow. Nice.
Yeah.
Our appreciation of his
So our daughters love anime and...
Is different.
I had family that was stationed there Okies. In Air Force, too. So I bet you guys were on the same base.
We're in Misawa.
There's three choices in the Air Force.
Is there?
It's way far up in the snowy north at Misawa.
So that's where you guys were.
They didn't tell stories about being frozen and snow monsters, which are the trees covered in snow. They weren't up there.
Ah.
If you were in Tokyo.
Japan's bigger than I imagine it is.
Yes.
It's a 12-hour drive from Misawa to Tokyo.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And then
that's a lot bigger than I thought it was.
South. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Through the nuclear fallout.
When you look at the globe, it's like a little kind of thing.
It's bigger than England.
Yeah.
So Japan's bigger than England.
Who didn't know that?
I've looked at a globe once or twice.
So the main island,
Yeah.
It's good sized.
And just so you guys don't, so you science geeks don't think that you're being left out, we always have a science guest.
Yes. Doctor.
Is Dr. Lonnie Johnson.
And what's Dr. Lonnie Johnson know?
He holds over 120 patents.
Oh, JBL and NASA?
Yes. He's a former U.S. Air Force. And he has his own companies as, you better
what
say that.
What really cool thing did he invent?
You need to tell him that.
Oh, the Super Soaker.
The Super Soaker?
He invented the Super Soaker?
The Super Soaker inventor is coming.
My hat is tipped to you.
Salute you, sir.
Making my childhood wonderful.
Yes. So made our summer times whimsical.
Sprayed by a Super Soaker, the inventor is going to be at SoonerCon.
That's awesome.
And
he has his own. No, it's the Nerf Blaster.
Nerf Blaster?
And all sorts of other
Yeah, the
things,
inventor of the Super Soaker and the Nerf Gun is coming to SoonerCon.
Yes. That's and fantastic. For those Trekkies out there, Trek connoisseur Larry Nemechek is coming back.
Okay.
We are one of the only cons that he continues to go to. Mm. Cool thing about Larry Nemechek, they had a reel that they were trying to incorporate into a movie, and they're like, hey, do you have the list of people that work this day? We can't find out who these doppelgirls are. Ooh.
Can I tell the story?
Sure.
Because as an actor, this is awesome.
It is.
So,
it ties in very well and ties the two
together. It was a dropped scene from one of the Star Treks. Which one was it?
It was from Nemesis.
Nemesis. The end where Picard is saying goodbye to the eternal lady that, you know, they're on that planet. Yeah. And so it on the end scene that was dropped, for any of you who watched Deep Space Nine.
Yep.
The
Ferengi.
What's his name?
Doesn't matter.
Anyway, the Ferengi character on Deep Space Nine, my brain just, you know, forgot his name, appears in an end scene that was deleted, and he has girls on each of his arms. Well, they lost the paperwork on the names of those girls.
And the permission to use them in the movie.
And the permission to use them in the movie, so they had to, because they wanted to include it in the next movie or in the Deep Space Nine episode.
In the outtake stuff that you hadn't seen.
Yeah.
And they couldn't. Because they didn't have the paperwork, and it was a SAG project, and SAG is very, 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 you know, up on making sure that if someone's going to use your image, that you get paid for it.
You need the proper paperwork. Did you find the paperwork?
Yeah. Yeah. To Larry Nemechek, hey, did anybody send you the...
Because he collects all of that stuff.
For that day, so we at least know who these names are.
Their names would be on the dude.
And... he's like, no, nobody sent me that day.
Oh, man.
Just that one day of the entire production.
Oh, geez.
Star Trek, Chicks Unknown. Yeah. The next.
And so he has the footage because they sent it to him. And so he does his own little thing at like 10 o'clock at night.
There's this funny story about this.
And Star Trek people that where he'll sit there and interact with a room and you do Star Trek trivia booby prizes and signed whatever
prizes he brings. Little things, both as an actor and as a geek to be like, that's so cool.
That's cool.
He has forgotten more Trek than most people will ever know.
Wow. Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah, he was one of the last people to interview, oh my gosh.
Roddenberry.
Roddenberry and also the woman who played Uhura.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, she just recently passed away.
Yeah, he was one of the last people to interview her.
Wow.
And he has the footage.
And so he'll sit in that room where you're learning all things geek and all things Trek.
You get to see.
You get to see and talk about it and talk with the person that's the last person.
Lots of cool stuff at CinerCon.
Lots of cool stuff. Very cool stuff.
And lots of cool stuff going on at Dead Center.
And
split your time.
Why do we do CinerCon? It's a nonprofit.
It is a nonprofit.
Who are we benefiting this year?
This year we are benefiting Positive Tomorrows. If you don't know what that is a school for homeless children or children who are in transition, who may not have a permanent address and therefore can't register in the school district. So Positive Tomorrows is a school, and we gave them over $6,000 last year, and we're hoping to match, or seriously, we want to blow the roof off of this. We have a charity store, and we also have a art auction, and the money is helping them go from K to what are they? Six.
They're K to six, and they want to go.
They want
to
K to eight. 12.
Oh wow!
Nice.
They want to get to K through 12.
Yep.
And that pays for the teachers. They have buses will go and pick up the kids wherever they are in Oklahoma City. It doesn't matter where they are.
The kids under a overpass that night.
That's where they're going to get the kids.
Yeah.
They feed them breakfast. They make sure they get washed. They make sure the kids are in clean clothes.
Wow.
They have a clothing closet for them. They give them the school supplies. So that way the kid has some stability
in their lives.
And they're not losing any time in their school for their parents being in this transitional period.
If they're couch surfing, I need to be picked up at my uncle's house tomorrow.
They'll come get
them. Yeah, they'll come get them.
There's a social worker in case one of the parents is going to court that day. Mm. There will be someone from the school there representing the parent. And... making sure that the kid understands that mom is going to be okay. And that type of thing affects the kids and their ability to learn.
Yeah.
And that's what we're trying to fund this year.
That's really cool. We actually haven't mentioned the website yet, but where can we find information about SoonerCon?
www.soonercon.com. It is copywritten now, and it is nonprofit 501c.
That's awesome. Yeah.
Yay!
So that'll be really fun.
And if you want to volunteer, there's a volunteer tab.
You have to volunteer before April because there's a background check. And this is a con. There's no paid positions. I'm on the board of trustees. I'm a volunteer here.
Nobody's paid.
Nobody's paid. And literally, for every hour that the con is there, there were 100 hours of planning that went into it.
Yeah. Wow.
And we still haven't signed our media guests. So
we're still looking for a couple guests. Always things in transition, but we're always looking for more people to come in, more people to help us, I started off as a volunteer. My wife, a year before me. For those of you that are following on the website, this is the first con that I was involved
on YouTube.
With.
Yeah,
and it's I'm holding my T-shirt and what I'm wearing. It was the 25th year of the SoonerCon, so I started volunteering 3 years ago.
That's awesome.
And then I was have worked my way up.
We just love caring and geeky stuff. And
it's through everything fandom.
It's because geeky stuff is.
Including this.
So much more interesting in life. It can't, is. You can't live life not getting to dive into the geekdom every once in a while.
Everyone's got a geek in them.
That's yeah. right.
Yes, yes, yes.
And if
yes.
you well, don't, you just haven't let it out.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly, yeah.
Okay, release the inner geek. Well, we're running a pretty long. Far
yeah, yeah,
beyond our time.
He's going to be editing
but do you think? How do you feel about doing like a really, really fast
speed round?
Game of pillars between
yes,
me and you?
Yes, let's do speed round pillars. Okay. We're going to utilize you guys for suggestions. Cool. So I've got you, Ryan. Yeah. You okay?
Mm-hmm. Aaron here. Girls are picking from girls and boys.
Yeah,
are
yeah. Boys it just so happened I was gazing upon you. And I had, so, yeah, let's get, I guess, like, Lainey.
Hey, Lainey.
Location.
Florida.
We're in Florida. Okay.
All right.
All right.
Let's just go with that.
Yeah.
Nothing else. All right.
Yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Did you bring the umbrella?
I brought the umbrella.
What about the towels?
I brought the towel.
But okay, and in the cooler.
Wait, you said towels?
Towels.
I brought a towel.
You didn't bring my towel.
Well, I brought the one towel.
Great. We're
you
gonna
said
share
grab the towel.
Towel. Right. But did you bring, in the cooler, did you get the?
Vodka.
The vodka.
I got rum.
Damn.
I'm sorry, you just said get the alcohol,
Damn.
And I grabbed the closest thing. It was the rum.
You don't bring my towel. No, you don't bring my vodka. What am I supposed to drink on the beach? I'm going to drink a...
Lemonade.
You can put rum...
From the man over there.
You can put rum in the lemonade. It's just as delicious as
rum
if you
lemonade?
Were drinking a...
Shirley Temple.
If you were drinking a Shirley Temple.
Oh, you know
a
I
very
like
alcoholic Shirley Temple.
Right. Okay, all right. Calming it down. We're at the beach. We're happy.
I just want to sit on the beach and I want to read my book about
murder.
About murder.
You do like
Very
your
peaceful
murder.
Time.
You do like your murder.
I love
right.
my murder.
All right. So, did you get the food? Did you get the
hot dogs?
Hot dogs.
I got the hot dogs.
You
I can guarantee I brought the hot dogs.
Hot dogs and rum and a towel. That's really all you need at the beach.
You can't go wrong with hot dogs and rum.
All right. Let's walk down to the beach. Watch out for the
beached whale.
The beached whale.
Ah, yes, the beached
Walk
whale.
Around, and I should.
You know, I love visiting this
like
beach.
That.
There's always the beached whale.
The beached whale. You know, I walk around it, let it rot.
I know. I can't believe it's been here since
December.
Since December.
It does. Take
of
quite,
2012.
It takes time to deteriorate, and you know, obviously, people are not that interested in.
You know, I saw a YouTube's video one time where they blew up a beached whale.
They blew it up.
They blew it right up.
Well, then how are you supposed to go inside and explore the insides of the whale? I thought this was a learning experience at the beach. They just blew it up?
What, this is an oceanic experience, not a spelunking tour.
Well, fine.
All right, anyway.
Watch out for the whale. Watch out for the...
Sushi bar.
The sushi bar, because you know last time I got sick.
Well, it smells kind of foul. I wonder if they're getting their materials from that beached whale.
It's probably a little bit of blubbers going into the sushi.
It's not the best.
All right. Well, I think we're ready to enjoy our nice... What is this? Our
15th.
15th anniversary?
It's our 15th anniversary.
We must have gotten married kind of old.
You know
I
what?
Like
I mean, you
sound
are my...
old.
You're of all the wives I've had, you're definitely number...
7.
You're number 7.
Well, you should have married younger.
So the
then,
fact that we lasted
just,
for 15 years
you know,
is quite an accomplishment.
You
thank you.
You should have married younger. I'm sorry that I was old, but
you know what? You have insulted me with your disdain for being number 7. This is our 15th year anniversary, and I thought it was going to be special. I'm going to go into the sushi bar, and I'm going to buy
spoiled meat.
I'm going to buy some spoiled meat just for you.
You know what? This is very awkward because actually, right here is my anniversary gift to you, and guess what?
Spoiled meat.
Gotcha.
Duh. That was good. Very, very fast, a little lightning round. Well, guys, thank you so much for coming on this show and talking about BK and about SoonerCon. One more time, where can we find you guys online with BK Talent?
www.bktalentagency.com. Shannon, you want to handle the
SoonerCon is...
Social media, we have a Facebook page, BK Talent Agency. And on Instagram and Twitter, it's at BK Talent Agency.
And SoonerCon is SoonerCon everywhere. That's now copywritten, so nobody else can steal anything about it. So
beautiful.
Just type in SoonerCon.
There you go. Well, thank you guys again for coming on the show. And for you listeners, check us out online at okishowshow.com. All the social medias at okishowshow. That's Twitter and Instagram. Check us out on Facebook. And if you like what you hear and you'd like to be a part of the adventure, go on over to patreon.com/okishowshow. And that's pretty much it.
That's right.
We'll see you guys in the next 2 weeks. Bye. Okie Show.